Hi, I'm Michael Correa, and this is Psych Exam Review. And in this video, I'm going to talk about the third variable problem. And this is something that I mentioned in the last video on correlations. So the third variable problem is this idea that when we do a correlational study, so let's imagine we have some data here. We go out and we measure two variables, X and Y, and we collect this and we see that there's a pattern. The problem is that we can't conclude anything about the causation. We don't know which direction causation is happening. It could be the case that X is causing Y. So as X increases, that causes Y to increase. It could be the case that Y causes X. So as Y increases, that causes X to increase. Or the third variable problem is that it could be that Z causes changes in X and Y. So Z is some other third variable that I didn't measure. I only measured two things, and it could be a third thing that wasn't in my study that's influencing both of the two things I measured. And the problem we have is that this possible third thing is infinite. It could be anything. So let's look at an actual example of this. Let's imagine that I did my study, and I went to a school, and I measured tons of students, and I measured them for X, which we'll say is their study time. And I measured their exam performance. So there's their score on the exams. And I found this data here. Now, you might look at that and immediately say, well, Mike, this seems obvious. Obviously, studying causes the scores. So studying more causes higher exam performance. That might seem obvious to you. But I can say, well, that's not necessarily the case. I can't conclude that. I can't conclude that causation. Because it could be the case that exam scores cause studying. You might say, well, how would that work? Well, it could be the case that students who do well on the exams throughout a course, that this motivates them to study more. They enjoy the class more, they're feeling competent, and therefore they study more. That could be the case, we don't know. Or it could be the case that some other thing, some other Z, causes both study time to increase and exam scores to increase. So what could this Z possibly be? Well, it could be anything, but let's start with some plausible explanations. We could say, all right, a potential Z that could be influencing this data would be teaching style. So it could be the case that students who have a teacher that they really like, they study more because they enjoy the class more, and then also they do better on their exams. They learn more because they like the teaching style. So it makes sense to them, and they do better on the tests. That's one possible third variable that could influence this data. Or you could say it might be parental pressure. So it could be the case that students whose parents put them under a lot of pressure are forced to study more. And because of this pressure, they also work harder to do better on exams. Okay. And students who have low parental pressure, their parents don't really care how they're doing, those students don't study as much. And also, they're not as motivated to work hard on exams because they don't really care. That's another possible third variable it could be. So it could be parental pressure causing this variation. Or it could be something that we wouldn't think of, or we wouldn't initially think of. Could it be coffee consumption? Could it be the case that the students who drink more coffee are awake more, and so they study more? They're able to stay awake and read more. Could it be the case that they're more alert during the exam? The coffee consumption is keeping them awake during a boring test, and the students who don't drink coffee are falling asleep. That's why they're not doing so well. Well, I can't rule this out because I haven't measured it. So I don't know for sure. It could be coffee, or it could be what they ate for breakfast that morning, or it could be literally anything else. Because I didn't measure, I can't say for sure that it's not that other thing. It's not their breakfast. So how would I go about controlling for this problem? I said, you know what, maybe it is coffee. Let's look into this. Well, one thing that I could do is I could do a matched sample. And all that a matched sample refers to is comparing samples that are matched for a third variable. So I have my group of students here. Hopefully it's going to be a lot more than four people in my study, but I have my whole group, and I find out that on average they drink 2 cups of coffee per day. And what I want to do is find another group of students who on average also drink 2 cups of coffee per day. And then I want to look at their exam performance, and I want to look at their study time. And if I find out that their performance and their study time is very different from my first group of students, even though they drink the same amount of coffee, then that tells me that the coffee is not causing the exam performance or the study time. That would be a matched sample. Another way I could do it, a more specific way, would be to match my students in pairs. This would be a matched pair design. And in a matched pair, what I would do is say, okay, here's a student, both of these students each drink one cup of coffee per day. Right? Here's a student who drinks two cups, here's another student who also drinks two cups. And here's the student who drinks three cups, here's another student who drinks three cups. Right? So each level of coffee consumption has a pair. And then what I do is I compare those pairs. I say, okay, this student drinks one cup per day, and he has high study time. And this student drinks one cup of coffee per day and has low study time. And this student drinks two cups per day and has high exam scores, and this student drinks two cups per day and has low exam scores. And then I would, by doing this for all of these pairs, I would be able to see if there was a pattern or not. I would say, okay, if they drink the same amount of coffee and they have very different scores and very different study times, then it's not coffee that's causing this pattern of variation. Now, the real problem here is that even if we eliminate coffee, we've only eliminated one item from an infinite list of other possible items. If it's not coffee, it could still be something else, right? No matter how many of these third variables I eliminate, I still can't say that studying more increases exam score or that higher exam scores causes people to study more. I can't say that because there's still the possibility of a third variable. You can measure everything that you can think of, and it could still be that thing that you didn't think of yet. So we're never going to get around this infinite third variable problem just by measuring. Right? Because when we only measure, there's a chance that it's something we didn't measure. So in the next video, I'm going to talk about the way we have for trying to get around this third variable problem. And what this technique attempts to do is to eliminate all third variables at the same time. And the way that we do this is called the experimental method. And so that's what we'll be looking at in the next video. I hope you found this helpful. If so, please like the video and subscribe to the channel for more. Thanks for watching.